Good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. We'd love for you to sing with us this morning.
Let's three people say, I'm glad you're here.
Sing all about you, yeah, you make me wanna sing. sense. I can't keep hallelujah off my lips now. You make me want to sing all about your love.
Smoker no more. Because I had to get my lighter up. I've been moving back. And we're all the Holy Spirit smokers in the house of God. Y'all can be out there helping me this morning. My ADD was kicking in, you know. Oh, man, God is good. Amen. Some people are really going through some struggles right now. And it's good to know that they got a church that's praying for them. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Little boy named Maxwell, we're praying gets out of the hospital. We're praying for Wayne and his family, Heather and Chris and Sam and the community. We're praying and believing that God is on the throne and he sits high and looks low and takes care of every need. We got several people with pneumonia and people going through different things in the church. And I think it's just a good morning that we would just hold hands and pray. Because he said, "Where one or two or three gathered, there I'll be." So hold your neighbor's hand. There's plenty of hand sanitizer at the back of the church. Just a minute, if you make a bad dash for it, because they're eating chocolate donuts in church or something, we're good. But seriously, I don't know where I'd be if I didn't have a church family that came together and held me, praying for me, put their hands on me. We got answered prayers for Miss Jennifer this week. Got answered prayers. Just as the devil worked, God working overtime. Come on, somebody, believe that with me. Devil, you have no authority over these lives and over these children and over our situation. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We bind up Satan in the name of Jesus. We call on your name, Lord, to join us in this service. Bind up Satan. We throw him out of our lives, throw him out of our family, Lord. We love our children. We hold our children. We thank God, Father, for every day you give us with each other. You thank you, Lord, that you give us our spouses, our freedom that we have. Somebody got a little freedom. You used to be locked up, but God set you free. That's enough to sing and shout. Some of y'all, man, God's turned your life from addiction to freedom. That's enough to stand and sing and shout. I don't worry what people think about me on the other side of the pew. God, you've done so much for me. I'll stand and shout and sing and lift my hand up because I know you're on the throne and I know you're taking care of us, Lord. And your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, Father. Father, I take a moment standing hand in hand, arm in arm with my brothers and sisters, and we lift up Israel to you this morning, Father. Father, no weapon formed against your people will prosper, Lord. Father, as the world watches, let them see you in all that we do. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Somebody say amen. Give God praise. Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Give me praise. Amen. Yeah.
Despite what the critics say,
despite what the haters might say, despite what you might say to yourself. I just wish Jana and Ellen would get one day right with God. I've been praying for a year now that they would just get one day right with God. I wish Shelton would one day get right with God and not be an imposter, an imposer, especially my wife, Scott, Frank, Granny. You think that Granny would not have to be anything to hide at her age? My gosh, she's going to go stand before the Lord in 2 or 3 days from now. You never know. But instead we get all dressed up, all prettied up, all puckered up, and fake. But God has done some amazing things here with people who come and get real and vulnerable with God and don't try to pretend like they this and that and the other. Billy Graham's grandson, Tolian, stumbled into this church, a broken man, broken in a million pieces, had one of the largest churches in the world, on TV, had a school, had 7 number one books in Lifeway, lost it all to sin. And then church does what church does good, because we're so good at faking it that when somebody is broken, really, we try to stay away from them and we try to treat them like a leopard. Oh, my God, they're a leopard. Oh, my God, here comes a drunk. Oh, my God, here comes a drug addict. Oh, my God, here comes somebody just got a divorce. I invited Tolian into this church. And what he received here was God's amazing grace. He finally got out of the church where everybody was an imposter into a place where everybody looked like him and had been through what he'd been. Because I know I'm sitting here right now with a bunch of people who've been divorced before, who've been cheated on before, or even have cheated. That's English, easy to understand. I'm sitting here right now with a bunch of people who were addicted, who've been to prison, who had money, or even still today got it all, but don't have it at all. You ever meet somebody got it all, but they ain't got it at all? Oh, I need to preach. Let's pray. Father, bless our offering. Thank you so much for each and every person that came to this church today. May they leave here vulnerable. May they leave here unadulterated, that they would have a moment with you today, Father, that they're not hiding anything. You know everything about them. You know what they're going through. You know their hearts, and you know what's going on in their life, Father. Father, I bring you into this place, Father, to help us. Say help us. Help us. Say like you mean to help us, Lord, to be vulnerable with you today, and that we would just, Lord, have your guidance and your love. And Lord, I thank you that we can come to you in the weakest and the darkest and the loneliest times of our life. And Father, even when it's mountain time, Lord, we can come and be with you. And Lord, help us to be vulnerable with you in every way of our life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Somebody give God a pray. Amen. Y'all like sing one chord. Thank you. You have no problem talking about it. If Jesus has saved your old sorry soul, you got no problem standing up, shouting, singing. If God has done a new work in you, you got no problem putting a cross on your back window. You don't care what they say or what they think. If these teenagers are really sold out to the Lord, they bow their head in the cafeteria and pray at school. They don't care what them other kids think. They just do it. And I want to read this scripture because I think it's so fitting with what God has laid on my heart. I'm tired of giving God somebody I think he might like. Write that down if you're taking notes. I'm tired of giving God somebody I think he might like. And I just want to be real. And I just want to be vulnerable with God. I wish you would just be real and vulnerable with God. Why are we not vulnerable with God, Brother Mark? I think we work so hard at not being vulnerable. And maybe that's because we have a past. And maybe it's because we made some mistakes. And maybe it's just because we've become the master of disguise. You talk good, you look good, you quote good scripture, but are you really good? Paul says he hadn't attained anything. He hadn't attained anything. He's looking for perfection, but he hadn't got it yet. Paul talks in the Bible, the hero of the Bible, if you want to call him, the hero of theology in the Bible says, I'm seeking perfection, but I ain't got there yet. I'm going to read it out the King James Version for some of you old folks. Hallelujah, Tommy, right? Tommy asked him one time, what do you got with the King? I got nothing against it. I just have trouble reading it. So, but I thought that this word was something that jumped off the page, and it says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, and if anybody's ever been chased by a rally, you know what apprehended means. I have not apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Paul's goal was perfection. Just like many of you, your goal is always perfection. Always having your best foot forward. Always coming to church with the best testimony. Always coming, got the biggest offering. Always coming, looking like this and looking like that, but on the inside, it don't look so pretty. And you haven't allowed yourself to get vulnerable with God because you keep pretending over and over and over. And you don't think that I ain't been doing this for 20 years, I can spot a fake? Bible says, by your fruits I know you. Right. Bible says the shepherd knows the sheep. Yeah. I can tell right away when something's going on in someone's life. It's like a gift that God's given me, and I try to help and I try to narrate. I ain't God, though. I'm going to go ahead and say that. I ain't God, but I try to help, instruct, teach, preach, love, wrap my arms around. But I ain't God. Let me tell you something. You ought to go to church to seek God, not preachers, teachers, Sunday school preachers, people. You ought to come to church just to have a moment with God where you can be vulnerable. And everybody, let me say this again, should be able to walk into a church without fear of you looking down on them like you're somebody, without acting like you're so much bigger and better than they are. Everybody should be able to walk into a church and feel like they're here for God, and that's the only reason they're here, not to be judged by us. Could it be possible that we think in our mind that God knew who I really was, he wouldn't love me? Maybe if I could keep being a poser, maybe if I can keep being an imposter, maybe if I can keep faking it, I can get to heaven. Let me tell you something. You can't do anything to get to heaven. You can't work yourself there. You can't buy yourself there. The only way to get to heaven is believing in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, right where you are, right now, this day. Choose who you will serve. Because let me tell you something. He won't love you anymore tomorrow. He won't love you any less tomorrow. He won't love you anymore. He won't love you any less. He loves you right now with an agape love, more than you could imagine, more than you could comprehend. The Bible says that God so loved loved the world that he gave his one and only son. I got two boys and I wouldn't give them up for you, but he gave his one and only son for me, and by that I am thankful. By that I am thankful. And I believe that. And he died on the cross for my sins, that he took mine in your place. And so out of fear of rejection, we think, well, we'll just pretend. I'll give God somebody that I think that he wants to see. I'll give God somebody. I'm afraid that if he saw who I really was, he wouldn't accept me. And Paul says the same thing. I count not myself to be apprehended. Paul says, I teach, I preach, but I haven't obtained it. I teach and I preach, but I haven't obtained it. Do you know what pressure it is on me and Mary? Let me talk to you for 1 minute. Do you know what pressure it is on me and Mary to teach you stuff that we haven't mastered ourselves? I come up here to teach you about your marriage and fight like hell with that woman all week long. I can come up here and tell you, turn the other cheek, forgive them 7 times 70, but I'll be on the phone with Rowdy talking about, ooh, let's just kill him, boy, let's just kill him. I know a place, I know somebody to hide the body. You know how hard it is for us who preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ and not have apprehended it? Because what happens is when you see that I'm not perfect, you point that out. When you see that the other person in your Sunday school class ain't perfect, you start hovering over there like, you know what I know? Do you know what I know? I don't care what you know. Do you know who I know? To help other people with their problems and then go home and try to figure out my own problems? Yeah. Well, I haven't mastered that. Raise and chill. I had a preacher call me this week, said, Brother Mark, pray for me. I said, what's going on? He said, well, I really don't want to tell you. I said, that's okay, I'll pray for you anyway. Well, let me tell you anyway. I said, what's going on, brother? He said, my daughter stole our car. She went and got high with her friends. We're raising her in church. We've had her in church her whole life, and she's headed down the wrong road with the wrong friends. And now she's totaled out our car. What do I do? All the people in church is going to know about it. I said, you bring her and set her right beside you. That's what they need to know about, that you love her regardless of what she's done, where she's been, how many mistakes she's made. You hold her accountable, she don't get no keys no more, she don't get no candy, she got to take the bus. But you let the church know, because she made a mistake, that God forgives her, and so does mama and daddy. Come on, somebody, I'm preaching way better than that. I'm raising children in church and our daughter's done messed up. I said, listen to me, brother, you can't control life, but you can control how you extend grace and mercy to those who sometimes seem like they don't deserve it. We'd rather spend our energy, watch this, I'm done. We'd rather spend our energy controlling our image. Let me do some damage control right here. You know how many people say some ugly stuff about me on social media? I hate when people put, hey, where are you going to church? Oh, go to Caney Creek Cowboy Church. And then somebody said, I went to that church and that dude's an idiot. That dude, one time they said I come out of a crack house. Now, I don't know which one of y'all's house I was at, but I hope you're not selling crack anymore. I hope you stop selling crack. There's a room around town. I saw Pastor Mark coming out of a crack house. Well, I didn't know it was a crack house. They called me everything. They said all kinds of stuff. I'm not apprehended anything. I'm trying to figure this out. Some of the stuff they said about me wasn't a lie. Some of the stuff they say about you ain't a lie. I was at one of the largest churches in the world. The preacher looked right at me. I was going through a wreck. Man, everything was coming against me. I felt like I was innocent until proven guilty. Until the pastor looked down from the pulpit and said, everything they said about you ain't a lie. Pierce my heart. Because, see, I've been faking it. I've been impostering it. I've been pretending it. I looked a lot like you guys. Figured out my little church walk. Figured out my little church talk. Figured out I can read all the scriptures in the Bible of every version today. I used to couldn't do that, but now I can. But don't matter how good I don't read. Do I have a personal relationship with God that I can be vulnerable with Him when I'm hurting, when I'm broke, when I want to go backwards instead of forwards? Is there anybody in this church that ever feels like you want to go backwards instead of forwards? Oh, some of you kept your hand down because you're a liar still. And let's do that one more time. You ever feel like you want to go backwards sometimes? I don't want to go to church anymore. I don't want to pay tithes anymore. I don't want to serve anymore. I don't want to pray anymore. My stuff is gone south, Brother Mark. My heart is broken. I'm confused. I'm lonely. I'm vulnerable. I'm all by myself. I'm surrounded by people, but I still feel alone. I don't want to do it anymore. Listen to me. When you're in that stage, get vulnerable with God.
Yeah,
just pour it all out to Him. Just pour it all out to Him. If your cup is starting to overflow, just pour it all out to Him. He says, give me all your cares. Give me all your burdens. I'll take every one of them away from you. Cast all your cares upon me. Oh, I wish the church would do that sometimes. That they would come and just lay down at the altar and say, Lord, I'm a mess. And I need you, Lord. Look at the energy we spend hiding our vulnerabilities to protect ourselves from people who many times don't even matter. You worry about people that don't even matter. You go pace the floor. That's what I learned in the ministry. I'll be up pacing the floor and my haters will be sound asleep. I'm like, fool, go to bed. Talking to myself, you know, fool, go to bed. Sometimes you try to impress everybody else that don't even matter. But if you put all that effort into being real and vulnerable with God and let Him do a new work with you.
There you go.
And Paul, of all people, my hero says, I know you're studying me this morning, Grimes, but listen, boy, I count not myself to have apprehended. Paul gets the words out and admits, I don't have it all together. But can love you anyway. I don't have it all together, but I can come pray with you. I don't have it all together, but I can still get up here on Sunday morning and preach to you. I don't have it all together, but I can still be a friend like Jesus to a friend who needs somebody. I don't have it all together, Paul says, but I can still teach you something. Paul goes on to say, I don't have it all together, but I can show you the value of life. Your life is valuable. See, Paul says, I can hold my wounds while I help stitch yours up. See, there are some people in this church, they're here to help you, even though they got troubles of their own. There are people in this church teaching your kids, and they ain't even got kids of their own. There are people in this church going the extra mile to help you on Friday night stay out of the bar and give you another opportunity when they're doing the sales or thinking about drinking sometimes. Yeah. I can help stitch up your scars while I'm still bleeding. Paul says, I count not myself to have apprehended is a real look at vulnerability. I think the reason that we are so afraid to be vulnerable is that the past teaches us to camouflage it. It teaches us to cover it up. The last time I tried to get real with, I got hurt. There's a new saying going around. I love it. 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 Because everybody, Janet says, well, I used to go to church, but I got hurt in church, so I don't go to church no more. Well, I went to McDonald's one time. They didn't put no pickles on my doggone burger. But 2 days later, I was hungry again. I went back for more, and I asked them to make sure that they put pickles on my burger. Church and God get put on the back burner so much because we're not willing to be vulnerable to say, God, yes, they hurt me. But I know it wasn't you. Can you help heal me, Lord?
Amen.
God, I know, Lord, that I'm still a mess and everybody's abandoned me. But, Lord, if I come to you, you can wrap your arms around me this morning. Last time I tried to be myself, I got fired. Pastor Mark told me to be myself, and I got fired. Last time I opened up to somebody, they betrayed me. You ever go and look for a prayer partner and then they betray you 6 months later when they mad at you?
Yep, yeah.
Y'all don't hear the words that are coming out of my mouth. Y'all don't do real church, do you? Happens. People in church, some of the worst I've ever met, some of the best I've ever met as well. But I still love church and believe you ought to be in church because it gets you closer to God. Last time I confided in her, she went out and told my business and tried to steal my man. Last time I told him about my marriage, he tried to steal my wife. Well, listen to me. Those are devils. Get you some angels around you. You'll find them in church. There's some good people in church. But we become masters of shutting out the pain and the hurt and the sorrow and the disappointment. And the only problem, the only problem is when you get really good at shutting things out, you don't get to let in the good things either anymore. Like joy and peace and happiness that comes from having a personal relationship with God. You built all these walls up around you. Now you're hard and now your exterior is tough. But let me tell you something. If you just be vulnerable this morning with God, let him tear down and chip away at that, you're going to find so much peace and so much joy and so much happiness in your life. I promise you that. I was the meanest individual you ever met. If you looked at me funny, I was ready to fight. I went to jail every weekend. I didn't care about nothing or nobody, not even my wife and kids like I was supposed to. Then I came to know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior on Father's Day 2005. A broken man who thought he had it all together made his way to an altar, and a Jesus that loved me right there at that altar took my brokenness and still using our brokennesses. I'm not wanting to go through the motions where I can't remember Thursday from Tuesday. I don't want my life to be numb because of the pain that I went through. I'm not sure what's going on in your life or why you're so numb and why nothing's changing, but maybe it's just because you haven't let yourself be vulnerable before the Lord. It's a tasteless life. You won't get any good honey and milk out of it if all the time you're trying to protect yourself, insulate yourself, board yourself up. You're missing the pain. I know you're missing the pain, but you're also missing the joy. Anybody ever been confused? Yeah, you're missing stuff, but you're also missing love, guidance. I think the Lord is calling roll this morning. Like some of you have been absent so long that he's calling roll. I love when I get them old school cats like Charlie and Brad. They do Sunday school the old way. All right, let's take a look. Who here today? Jack. But I know people, Charlie, that are coming to your class that ain't coming to your class. That's English, easy to understand. I know people that are coming to this church every week, but they ain't coming to this church every week. I know people that are going home and married, but they ain't married no more. Maybe God will call roll on us this morning and call us by name this morning. Maybe you're having things go on in your life and you're saying, Lord, here I am. Please help me. Lord, here I am. Call my name, Lord. I want to come forward. Call my name, Lord. I want to be in a relationship with you like I used to have. I want to have a relationship with you like I used to have when I first got saved, when I first got into church. I want to get back to where it's me and you and I'm having fun, Lord. And I'm not scared and I'm not afraid and I'm not afraid to die. I want to live, Lord. How many would come to God and just be vulnerable? Not just come to church, but come to God and just be vulnerable. I love this church. No, the building's not perfect. It's hot as hell in the summer. It's cold in the winter. And when it rains, those blue chairs you sit in might have some wet spots. Or it could be from somebody that said in it before that didn't tighten up their diaper. Just saying. No, the building's not perfect. It's hot in the summer, cold in the winter. No, we don't have a lot of money. Most of the time our fences are down and our cows are out. We got a smoking section. We got some wild kids. We got a preacher and his wife that hadn't apprehended it. But I'm not finished yet.
Amen.
And God's not finished with you yet. I'm not complete. And you're not complete yet. If people don't like things holding that ain't complete. They don't like to walk into a youth building and to not be complete. You know why people leave this church a lot of times? Because they don't look like the big one across town with all the money. That's okay. You go over there. They don't have crosses in those churches anymore. More than that, they don't have Jesus in those churches anymore. They don't have the truth in those churches anymore. They don't have the Word of God in those churches anymore. They might have good air conditioning and seats without rats. You better take somebody like this in.
Amen.
And love them.
Yeah.
And accept them. No matter what they've done in their life. Watch God. I said, told them you're going to come to work for me and experience God's second chances. Let me read a little bit of this to you. It's pretty cool. He dedicated 8 pages out of the church. Ain't that pretty cool? But the story's even better. Because I believe the church is really important how the leadership goes. And the people in leadership, whether it be in the cleaning crew, or the arena crew, or the Sunday crew, or the breakfast crew, they got to be right with God and love people around here the right way. I'm telling you what, if they're not in spirit with the right way to love people, then we get them out of the way, because we know how important it is to make room for one who's broken. Hurt. In the fall of 2016, my new wife, Stacy, and I were living in Willis, Texas. The first year of our marriage for any couple has been a challenge, but if one, I ain't going to lie, going through a soul detox, rehab, I didn't even know what to call it. I just said it was hard. Stacy was working for a title company, and I was doing the dishes, folding clothes, going to the gym, going to counseling twice a week, trying to figure out what the hell happened to my life and what the hell I was supposed to do for the rest of it. And most importantly, who the hell I was anymore. That's when the cowboy called. That'd be me. I wrote a book called God Don't Call the Equipped. He equips the ones he called. I was looking to get it published. Tom was helping me try to get it published, and Donnie, I found out Donnie's son-in-law. Donnie said, go talk to my son-in-law. I said, who's your son-in-law? Billy Graham's grandson. I said, what? You never told me that. He said, yeah. He set a meeting up with us. I called him, asked him if he wanted to go to lunch. Told him I wrote a book and I was trying to get it published. He agreed to meet with me. Here's a verse he put, surely the Lord is in this place, and I do not know it, Genesis 28:16. The verse is Jacob talking after he wakes from his dream of the stairway of heaven and deceives his father, and after he cheated his brother. He'd been up to a lot of no good, yet he roused awake with an awareness of the nearness of God. I'd say let's not chalk that up to Jacob's captivity for awareness, but rather God's commitment to nearness. I don't have an angel dream like Jacob. I didn't have an angel dream like Jacob had, but my phone rang in January 2017, and it was Mark Grimes, who I surely didn't think was no angel at first, but I came to believe that differently. Mark pastors Caney Creek Cowboy Church in Grangerland, Texas. If you don't know about cowboy church culture, then you need to know. They're not like a local gathering. They're often in a bar or an arena setting where the vibe is come as you are. The preaching is straightforward, plain, and to the point. People come in boots and buckles and blue jeans. When it comes to their music, it's often a band with loud guitars and fiddles. We don't have a fiddle, but if you play fiddle, let us know. You're welcome to hitch your horse outside or even bring a Harley. Seriously, that's what Pastor Mark's tagline is, Caney Creek Cowboy Church, boots, suit, horses, and Harley, everybody's welcome. Mark, amen. Mark had heard I was in the area and he knew from my story in the news cycle. He got my number from Stacy's dad and played the electric guitar in the church. When Mark called, he told me he was interested in writing a book and asked if I was willing to meet him for lunch. I had nothing but time on my hands, so I agreed. Even though I had no idea what Mark looked like, when he showed up, I knew it was him. Big truck, big hat, big buckle, big boots, big boy. As different as we were, we hit it off immediately. We talked about the book he wanted to write for a few minutes, but then he abruptly changed the subject. He looked at me and put all the cards on the table and said, I'd like to help you. I think if we'll be vulnerable and let God really fix us, then he's going to bring people into our life that we're really able to fix and help. Would you let yourself be vulnerable? It's a great book and a lot more in there, and pretty cool to be in that book. But more than that, it's pretty cool to be the pastor of this church and be as vulnerable week to week. Because me and Mary, we're no different than anybody in this church. We're trying to figure it out just like you. We haven't apprehended it. But one thing we do is we press forward. Yeah. If you keep reading that scripture, here's the key to that whole scripture. Paul says, I haven't apprehended. I make a lot of mistakes. I'm trying to teach. I'm trying to preach. But I still fear. I still worry. I still have my own problems. But then he goes on to say, if you've ever studied this, it's really cool to study it. I'm done. I'm really, 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 really done. He goes on to say, he says, I forget the past and I move forward. When I read that, man, my skin just jumped off. My hair jumped off my skin. And I read that and I said, you know what? That tells me right there that the past ain't as important as the future.
Amen.
Maybe you've done church. Maybe you've been in church. Maybe you've had experiences in church. But you never let yourself be vulnerable with the Lord. How about doing that this morning? Stand with me. Let my men and women come forward. I hope you get you a copy of that book. Great book. Grace and Carnage, they do go together. Every head bowed, every eye closed. My mission now is to provide a safe place for people to kind of get away from everything else and escape for a moment. I want Caney Creek Cowboy Church to be a safe place, a place where a person needs to be vulnerable, they can be vulnerable. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I want my mission and your mission as a church, let it change this morning. Let our mission be that to provide a safe place where people can get away from everything, escape for a moment, a place to provide a safe place to for a person to talk, or even if they don't want to talk, they can just come. A place for people to just be and find the Lord Jesus Christ. Because I think a lot of times we get so motivated to introduce people to God. Stephanie Bressinger said this, God once told her, I'm so much better at being found than you are at introducing me. I'm so much better at being found than you are at introducing me. She said, the Lord told her, he's so much better at being discovered than you are at setting the table for people to find me. So I think our mission, church, now is to provide that space for people to come and get away and find hope again, find peace again, find joy again, and ultimately find the goodness of God. I hope this Sunday morning, this church brings you hope. It gives you something to hold on to in your darkest days. But ultimately pulls you out, gives you a space where you can discover the goodness of God, the goodness of our Lord Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, if there's anybody in this place or watching live around the world that has never gave their life to you this morning, I pray that right now you would just Give your life to Jesus. Be vulnerable. He knows everything already. You're not hiding anything from him. Give your life to him right now. Just say, dear Lord, please forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart and save me. Today I make you my Lord and Savior. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Today I make you my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart and save me. If there's anybody else in here that needs prayer, get up and come forward right now. Don't worry about anybody else. Slide out. We got men and women up here that will pray for you. Come right now. You need the altar by yourself? Come. Be vulnerable with God. We're not in no rush this morning. You've been going through stuff. You want to come lay that down at the altar or grab somebody to pray with you? Come right now. We're going to give you a few minutes. Stand in agreement with me, church. This is a holy place. A safe place. A safe space. People to meet Jesus. Come right now, don't wait. Day. Thank you for this church time. Thank you for these moments where we can come get real with you today. It's in your precious son's name we pray. Amen. Somebody give God praise. Amen. Guys, this is a safe place. Don't judge nobody here. Let's love people because none of us are perfect. None of us have apprehended it. Amen. God bless y'all. Thank y'all so much for coming today. You are dismissed. God bless you.